Well, I'm noticing a clear pattern in how we are being treated, you say. You lean in close to Kriya. Perhaps best we seek out and kill the imposter now before we are discovered. Kriya holds up a finger dismissively. When I wish your advice, Worm, then I will ask for it. Sighing, you straighten up. Look at the pleasure in her eyes, says Egra. Sure enough, Kriya has begun grinning as she scans the crowd. You don't know how she could be enjoying herself with all this blinding daylight, even with the cloudy day. This is obviously a religious ceremony, as you spot an inordinate number of priests in the crowd. The nature priest stands out in particular. What the fuck is a nature priest? At first you took them as barbarians, unwashed and mostly naked other than furs and garments that appear to be made of tree bark. What must be a ranger strides along with them. Like you, he has a bow, although it is shorter. His travel cloak is stained. His eyes are constantly roving like an animal. Okay. Wait, is that ranger the same guy, the cuck? That could be a problem. Wait, no, we are as a dark elf, right? But still, our bow is that of a wood elf, which could be a problem. This might be the worst possible place for a godling to hide, you say to Egra. How long before one of these fanatics sniff you out? Better hope they do not, says Egra. It might be wise to know what people are saying about you. You shut your eyes and listen. Your dark elf ears are excellent. Nevertheless, with the music so near, the multitude of voices, you cannot make out any words. Says to Kriya that you move somewhere else. Now, keep listening. Continue to listen, straining to make out any words. Gradually some words come. That dress, I rather think, need a harp. Cave pixie, I will not dance with. Pain lances across your cheek. You open your eyes and stagger back into a defensive position. Kriya is glaring. Did you slap me? You ask. Do not stand there with your eyes shut like one of those dung-smeared nature priests, she hisses. We must keep our wits about us if we wish to survive this quest. Naval scrotums, you will not slap me again, you say. Kriya leans in closer. It is what is expected for an inattentive slave. You must both play the role we are dealt. I was keeping my wits, you say. I was trying to listen in what was being said about us. Kriya shakes her head. As have I, a fool's errand here, though. Let us move away from this so-called music. She leads you away. Start by behaving like your race, says Kriya. Really? Really? Alright. See, let me tell you. Let's Dance is going to be one of those weird ones where we just get slapped but get one morale or maybe a favor. Obviously, that was easily deducible. The second option, or rather the third one, which we took is the first one was listen, right? So I listened because that was the most appropriate. The third one was to ask Kriya to move. And as we have established from the start of this chapter, maybe the end of the last chapter, that since she's so superior to us right now in social status, it is not our place to tell her to do anything. Henceforth, if I told her to, normally this would not be a problem, because if you were with someone who's just acting, then if you told them that, they would obviously move after making a little thing like, oh, how dare you come near me. But they would not actually be thinking that, because they're just like, okay, this is good, but I need to keep the act up. However, she is clearly just living out her fantasy at this point of being a dominatrix, and her fantasy of being a dark elf. So how exactly was I supposed to deduce that was that? There's a lot of questions and I need a lot of answers. I'm maintaining my cool, as you have seen. I have not raised my voice much this episode. I'm really, really trying to maintain a cool mind. The show is pushing me with these incessant nonsensical choices. Regardless, what is our plan? You ask Kriya once you're far enough from the minstrels to hear properly. What exactly are minstrels? I think they're just like entertainers, right? I think. Or maybe they're clergymen, I don't know. To hear properly, what do dark elves normally do at a party? They are aloof and treat others with contempt, says Kriya, her nose again in the air. Gods, no wonder everyone hates us, you mutter. You raise your voice. I would rather mingle. We do not mingle with this rabble, says Kriya. Once we are in the inner ring and nobles are among us, then we might initiate contact. You nod absently as you look over the crowd. Finally, you spot a familiar face. The halfling puppeteer you recently paid. Recently, the agent of House Ruda here. Against your better judgment, you find yourself striding towards her. Come back here, Kriya whispers behind you. You have had enough of Kriya and her instructions of dark elf behavior. You will not waste your new form by dolting about like standing about like a dolt. The halfling appears to be in the middle of a private impromptu puppet performance for a young couple. Sire, your woman, as a fine-shaped rump on her, what says the puppet, which is styled. Okay. So the puppet is saying your woman has a nice rump. Seriously, looks like a smaller wooden version of the halfling. The wooden puppet's hand reaches out of the woman's midsection. The woman squeals and leaps back. Her man smiles and tut-tuts at the puppet. For a child, that is a fine bit of ventriloquism, says Egra. Not a child, that's a halfling who is certainly much older than I am. You say to Egra, as a godling, how do you not know this? I'm still learning of your native universe. My father whispers to me only sometimes, and your memories are like a heaping pile of trash, says Egra. You bring up your memory of the halfling for Egra. After a pause, she says, oh, you're braver than I thought if you mean to bother her. Okay. You suppose halfling's ventriloquism is magic, you say? Merely a trick of the voice, says Egra. You suppose the trickster godling would know the difference. As your shadow falls over the halfling, she looks up at you, her small shoulder tenses up for a moment, and then she scowls. Private show, she says. What do you say? And now you shall amuse me too, little one. What do you think of my rump? I think you misplaced the puppet. Okay. That's, I don't know if that's a good one. I mean, that is very enticing. I think you misplaced a puppet. But, I'm gonna go with this one. What do you think of my rump? You ask the halfling, turning your backside to her and wiggling. The halfling looks up at you, her eyes showing surprise. She quickly recovers, takes a cursory look at your behind and says, better for us all if ye cover it proper. You have no affection for elven rump, you ask. that another joke. What the fuck is this tone of speaking? Ne'er heard. Cave pixie making no jokes. There's somebody else dead or getting that torture. What the fuck? The young couple has been inching away from you, their eyes flitting about nervously. You think you know everything, small one, you say, grinning as you lean down. Perhaps the gods have a few more surprises before you leave this miserable world. Hope so, says the halfling with an evil grin. And now, here a surprise for you, pixie. She punches you in your loins, or rather, her puppet does. You double over in pain. Now that was magic, says Egra. Obviously, no little puppet hanging on strings could punch that hard. Why did she do that, by the way? I don't quite get it, because... normally, I mean, the reason why I'm not mad is because I don't quite get that one, because we came up to her and we were not rude and she was clearly wary of us, but now we are buddies and we are kicking each other in the balls. What the fuck is happening? Okay. Obviously, no little puppet hanging on strings could punch that hard. As a pain continues to flood through your nether region, you wonder if you will ever secretly spread your seed throughout the royal family, as you have often fantasized. Not really, my body, you console yourself. By the time you have recovered enough to look up, the halfling had disappeared into the crowd, of course. Alright. A tug at your shoulder and a weight is lifted. Kriya is standing next to you, opening the knapsack you have been carrying. She looks inside, she sighs in relief. Thank you, I'll be fine, you say. The sarcasm in your voice thinly masks the pain behind each syllable. I told him to sleep. You must have woke him, she says. She whispers some strange words into the knapsack. Tell Hoss thank you for the protection, you say, as this time nailing the sarcastic tone. Are you quite done playing the fool, says Kriya as she closes her knapsack and slings it onto her own back. She leans in close, lowers her voice. How do you think it reflects on me to have you make a spectacle of yourself? Me, you say, taking a shuddering breath, straightening up. You swagger about as though you were the Duchess herself by barely covering your nether regions. You were just punched in the crotch by a puppet. Kriya whispers fiercely, you're a disgrace to our kind. Our kind, you say? This is not permanent, despite your wish to the contrary. Are you certain it's not permanent? Says Egra in a teasing voice. Okay, sure. Kriya purses her lip. Do not presume to guess what I wish, she says. My point is, how will we gain access to Bonebrow without dignity? Says Kriya, he will not want to be seen with us. As a wizard, it is your nature to overthink and fret, you say. I know you wish me to continue to play as your cowering slave, but I wish to take this opportunity to learn a few things about disguising in this form. What did you learn from the halfling other than you can be whipped by a small puppet, says Kriya. Well, for a start, House Ruda here does not fear the dark elves, you say. Kriya lowers her voice even further. Was the puppet master you met with the agent... Wait... Was that the puppet master you met with, the agent of House Ruda here? You nod. Yes, in case you did not know already, the organization you owe coin to are very powerful. What else did you learn? Asked Kriya. My power of transformation is complete, you say with a superior smile. The puppet master has met my real self before, yet she has no idea who I really was. Despite her obvious familiarity with magic, she even called me Cave Pixie. Huzzah to you, says Kriya sarcastically. Yeah, she just, well, we actually got a lot of information out of that, so that's good. So we know that Egra's magic is pretty good. We already knew that, but I don't know how it would stand up to a priest. I think normal priests would not be able to detect it. I think a high priest, like the one we accidentally saw with the paladin, would be able to detect it. The puppet master has... Yeah, we already seen this. You earned the longer version of the slur. Normally, they just call us Pixie. Pixie, you say. That does not sound so bad. Is not a pixie merely a small creature that runs about the forest and causes mischief? Exactly, Kriya says, her lip curling up. Imagine you are a proud dark elf, ruler of the Underdark, being compared to one of those. You shrug. Well, I will try to act offended, I suppose. Yeah, that was the least offending thing. Like, I know what a fucking pixie is. Technically, let me make a comparison. You know, evokers in Minecraft, right? Essentially, a pixie would be similar to the vexes that it spawns. Just think that the vexes are less annoying, I suppose. Maybe the vexes are more annoying, I don't know. I mean, vexes are really annoying in that fucking... in Minecraft. Like, they're so annoying, dude. They can pass through walls and just hit you constantly. It's just a fucking swarm with them. But regardless, I think pixies depends on which fantasy world you're talking about. I think the pixies from Hogwarts are really annoying. However, I've seen pixies that are really friendly from some other fantasy worlds. So, well, I suppose these seem like more mischievous kind that are not as... They probably just annoy the passing travelers by this doing this and that. It does not sound like they're really causing much damage. But I suppose that is that. Kriya just knapsacks some more, and you smile, knowing that she will now be bearing the burden of her heavy rodent familiar. Getting that thing off your shoulder for the rest of your day was almost worth the kick. Almost. Since you arrived, you and Kriya have enjoyed a relative space around you in the crowd. You're surprised when you see a pair of people approaching out of the corner of your eye. Adopting your most pompous expression, you turn to them. It is a man and woman close to their twilight years. What exactly are twilight years? I think, like, old age, right? The man's eyes are fastened on Kriya like she's a pile of jewels. The woman smiles slightly, managing to appear like she might actually mean it, while not betraying any more wrinkles than necessary. They're both dressed in silver chains and brooches, enough to deflect a sword blow. Ooh, that's an interesting analogy. Well, not an analogy, an observation, I suppose. So they're wearing so much jewelry and brooches and stuff like that, that if someone struck them with a fucking sword, they would act as armor, honestly. That's interesting. The man bows low as the woman curtsies. The man then addresses Kriya. My lady, I'm Frederick Hallowflame. Hallowflame, not Hollowflame, interesting. And this is my wife, Cinta. We are pleased that you would join our humble celebration. Okay, these are names that I've not heard before. That much is sure. I'm still worried when we're going to the Duke's castle. Now, I think three creatures I'm kind of worried about. Three in name, obviously you know Bone Bra, I'm not counting him, but the ones that I'm kind of worried about are the two women we met in the first episode, the noble women, I don't remember them, from Middle Ring. And as for, what was the name again? I don't think we know her name. We know her name, but I forget the name. The one antique collector, I forgot her name. But yeah, she. Let's see.